the good fight of faith.
Amen.
Why do you think the devil's fighting you so hard?
Come on, man.
Why do you think he's attacking your mind, your health?
Yeah.
Just buried, right before Christmas, we just buried our oldest sister. And we're in a time of mourning and grief, but the Lord began to speak to me and said that unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it can't live. Oftentimes, God puts you through the pain, through the grief, through the... You know, when God tests you, he doesn't put you in a microwave. He puts you in the oven. When God molds you and makes you... I wish I had a church to preach to tonight. When God molds you and makes you, he don't put you in a 3-minute microwave and then you're out. He puts you in the oven. And then he turns the heat up. And then when you think you're ready, he said, nope, still got to work in you. Hallelujah.
Right.
Alignment. Paul was saying, I got to align myself if I'm going to win this race. Church, if we're going to win this race, if we're going to get victory in 2019, we're going to have to align ourselves in these areas. Can I give you something tonight? Just 4. I'm going to use it in a little acrostic, spelling out the word align. For it, you're going to have to align your attitude. Praise God. Now, there's only 2 kinds of attitude in the world. Good ones and bad ones. There's some people who still don't like you for something you did 20 years ago. There's some people that look like they've been baptized in pickle juice coming to church. God bless you, brother. God bless you, sister. Man, it'd be better if you don't even say God bless you. Amen. We're going to have to align our attitude with the word of God. I define attitude like this. This is my definition. When you preach your sermon, you can preach your sermon. But since I'm preaching, I'm going to give you my definition. My definition of attitude is expecting the best, but being content with the outcome. Oh, y'all just missed that right there. So let me go a little bit slower. Expect the best. No, I'm just kidding. I better not go that slow. What is a good attitude? You expect the best. You believe that, God, this could be the day that that miracle, way maker, promise keeper, miracle worker, this could be the day that I get a breakthrough. You go to your job saying, my Lord, I'm blessed coming in, I'm blessed going out. You come to church, God's going to do miracles today. God's going to do signs today. God's going to do wonders today. It's going to be a packed house tonight. It's going to be overflowing. Well, what if it doesn't happen, Pastor? Then you just be content with the outcome. Because God doesn't work on our schedule. He works on his time schedule. Maybe he's waiting on your attitude to change so that your circumstances can change. Stands for loyalty. I believe that if we are going to reach our potential this coming year and achieve the goals and the aspirations that God has placed in our heart, we need to be loyal. We need to honor the Lord with our commitments and have our priorities in check. I know you've read this scripture, but I'm going to read it for those of you who haven't read it. Matthew. Go to Matthew's gospel real quick in chapter 6. Are we doing all right, church? All right, Matthew. I was in Mark, but I need to go to Matthew. Amen. Mm-hmm. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. No one can serve 2 masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon.
That's right.
One translation says, you cannot serve God and be enslaved by money. What is God saying there? Make sure your priorities are in check this year. Don't be chasing money. Chase God. When you chase God, money starts chasing you. Maybe you're in a situation right now and you got all these things on your schedule, all these things. Well, let me encourage you. This year, don't do hard things first. Don't do easy things first. Don't do fun things first. Do first things first. Put God first this year. And he says if you do that, I will add things to your life. You hear this one? Now you're going to really high five me on this one. You're going to really shout. You know what we need to align ourselves with this year? I believe there's something the Lord's speaking to my heart. I know it's speaking to you. We need more integrity in our lives. More integrity. Matthew 5:37, I won't do it for sake of time, won't read it, but the Bible says, let your yes be yes, and your no be no. This is the year that you know your yeses and you know your no's. And you need to know them before you get in the battle of pressure.
Come on, Pastor.
I have learned something about integrity. My definition of integrity is walking in the truth all the time. It means I don't lie on my tax return. You're going to have to give me a ride after church, Pastor. I don't lie about how many hours I worked. I'm walking integrity.
That's right. Yes.
I do what's right because I know God is watching me. I don't really work for man. I work for God.
Yes.
And everything that I do, I got to align myself with truth. So I learned something about integrity. When you got integrity, there's some people who don't. And they will beat you down with their lack of integrity. There are people that want to compromise with you. Come on, it's not going to hurt. Come on, it's not going to send you to hell. Anybody ever heard that one? Come on, just take, you can drink beer and still be a Christian.
Well, right now.
I thank God I'm going home with my wife tonight, yes. It's all right to sip a little bit. First of all, just common sense. Why would you want to align yourself with something that has killed more people on the road, on highways, and say you love God? See, we got some Christians that say, what can I get away with and still be a Christian? That's the wrong question. I can't get no help in here tonight. I thought I was in church. I think I was in the library tonight. About grace. We need to align ourselves with the truth about grace. John Piper said these words, grace is the enabling gift of God not to sin.
Yes.
He said grace is power.
That's right.
Not just pardon.
It's not an excuse.
All right, since brother said come on, I want to come on. So here we go. Titus, real quick. Titus chapter 2. Can y'all give me about 5 more minutes and I'll be done? Anybody give me 5 more minutes? Raise your hand and give me 5 more minutes. All right, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45. I got a whole hour, praise God. Thank y'all very much. I appreciate that. Y'all are so sweet. I thought y'all would know that one by now. Y'all fell right into my head. You were smiling when I said it. You already knew it. But you love me so much, you just played along with me. Titus chapter 2. Verse 11, for the grace of God brings salvation and has appeared to all men. But we got to read on. The grace of God teaches us to deny ungodliness.
Yes, Lord. Preach it.
How come nobody preaching about that grace?
That's right. Amen.
The grace that we have denies ungodliness and worldly lust. And we live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. The real grace of God is not a license to keep sinning and sinning and sinning. If you are really a Christian, you don't want to sin anymore. You don't want to break the heart of God anymore. You don't want to do things that dishonor God's word. Amen. If you love God, you want to stay away from sin. That doesn't mean you won't sin, but you don't want to sin. But when you do sin, you confess your sins before the Lord and say, God, I don't want to go that way anymore because I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. Now, what caught my eye is he goes on to say, you got to put off the old man. I'm not going to take the time to read it. Time is availing us. He said, I got to put off the old man. We got to put off the old man, church. We got to put it off. Right. If we don't put off the old man's going to win. So we got to put it off. We got to make conscious decisions and say, you know what? I'm not going to do that anymore. Now, we got a saying that we like to say at our church, and I know y'all said it here. I may not be the person I'm supposed to be. But thank God I'm not the person I used to be. Hallelujah. I may not be the person I'm supposed to be sometimes.
Yeah, that's right.
You may see one thing incredible that I love about Jesus, Julian. is that when he appeared after the resurrection to Thomas, he said, Thomas, it's me.
Yes.
Prove it. Look at my scars. If Jesus wasn't afraid to show his scars, why are we? Bring your scars to church. Bring your hurts to church, but don't stay at home and feel sorry for yourself and have a pity party. Because I've learned one thing about a pity party. Nobody buys your balloons. Don't feel sorry for you. Pastor hadn't called me this week. You don't need him to call you.
All right, now, speak it.
Start learning how to grow up in the things of God. Pastor didn't visit me this week. So what? The Holy Ghost will visit you anytime you call on his name. My confidence is not in pastor. My confidence is not in the leadership.